Well, good morning, everybody. Hey, listen, on your way out today, as long as they last, we've got about 25 or so apples. They're on the pew and they're for you to take. These were from last week, and we had a great weekend. We had a great week. Things went really well last weekend, and we appreciate Daniel and Kristen Curtis putting that all together for us. And then we got through the Grand Prix with all the kids there and had so many parents, and we appreciated that opportunity. And Aaron did a lot of work on that, and Christy, of course, was there to help. So these are left over. And I went through and I found one. This is the only one that would appear to have a wormhole in it. And Daniel, it's yours. I don't want anybody else to get that one. You're man enough, you can take that. All right. Hey, I read this week, and perhaps you've wondered, do I really belong here? I mean, there are so many things wrong in my life, I don't even know where to start. Well, I want you to know this is the right place. And some of you heard this earlier, but let me read it to you. I thought it was informative and entertaining both. If you can start the day without caffeine, I'm not going to ask all the questions, but how many must have caffeine to start the day? All right, so many of you are already out of the list. If you can start the day without caffeine, if you can get going without pep pills, if you can always be cheerful, ignoring aches and pains, if you can resist complaining and boring people with your troubles, if you can eat the same food every day and be grateful for it, if you can understand when your loved ones are too busy to give you any time, if you can overlook it when those you love take it out on you when through no fault of yours something goes wrong, if you can take criticism and blame without resentment, if you can ignore a friend's limited education and never correct him, if you can resist treating a rich friend better than a poor friend, if you can face the world without lies and deceit, if you can conquer tension without medical help, if you can relax without liquor, if you can sleep without the aids of drugs, if you can honestly say that deep in your heart you have no prejudice against creed, color, religion, or politics, then, my friend, you are almost as good as your dog. Never thought about it. But that would be a pretty good effort to strive for, to be as faithful and as consistent as those dogs we love so much. Hey, if you're not this good, you're in the right place. The truth is, there's a lot of work that needs to be done in all of us. And we're going to start the day by worshiping the Lord, and then, of course, submitting ourselves to the examination of God's Holy Spirit as the Word of God is being preached. All right. Hey, Daniel.
Well, again, good morning. We're glad you're here. If you'd stand with us this morning in Christ alone, and in Christ alone our hope is found. In Christ alone there is no guilt, there is no shame, because he has taken care of all of that on the cross. In Christ alone. pray, Heavenly Father, Lord, it is in you and in your Son alone, Lord, that we can find our hope. Lord, we know that every day that your mercies are new. We know that every day your grace is always sufficient, no matter the need. And Lord, I just thank you for the strength that we can find in you, the hope that we have in you. And I just I thank you for this day that we can be together to sing to you about that, to give you the glory, to give you the honor. And Lord, that we would learn what you've called us to do, Lord, what you have done for us, and that we would thank you for that. We do thank you for that. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Greeted neighbors, you're being seated this morning.
We'll kind of go through this morning's announcements. First off, you know what's worse than a worm in your apple? A half of a worm. The boys get tired of me telling that joke. But anyway, well, start out with here. Bill Fred was here at the early hour, so we know that he's gone, so we'll go ahead and announce this. The Freds are having a surprise birthday party for Bill. It'd be his 70th birthday. This coming week, April 1st, down here at the FBT Center from 2 to 4. So put that on your calendars. Remember, it's a surprise, so supposedly he's not supposed to know about it. Also, kind of going down through our list here this morning, choir practice tonight at 6:30. And also, as Bruce said, we want to give a big thank you to everybody that helped out with the Grand Prix and in the Sunday last week, with which was FBT Sunday, and all that they did there. There were several people involved and that helped out in all different facets there. So also we have the missionaries Aaron and Stephanie Cockrell coming to visit with us next Sunday morning on April 2nd. We'll have a dinner afterwards. Aaron will be providing the message in the 10:30 hour, and then after that we'll have a meal. If you're interested in staying and having lunch with them, there's a sign-up sheet in the back, right? So just put your name down there. Or if you don't know yet and you want to kind of see how the week goes, as long as you call the office by Friday, is that what you need to know, so that they can order? We're going to have lasagna and salad and green beans and stuff like that. The church will provide, if you can bring a salad or a dessert, right? Yeah, dessert, yeah, or salads, or whatever. Go ahead to add to the meal there. So, I guess that's mainly announcements. We do on the prayer list. If you turn over to the back of the bulletin, we'll kind of go through a little and point out a couple of them that we need special interest there. Emily Ann Mangelsdorf, we want to keep her in our prayers. She's had some health concerns here recently with an infection, and they're assembling some doctors there to see what the best route to go with. John Cunningham has been moved to, he's in Lutheran at Fort Wayne. Still several health concerns there. Keep him in our prayers. Also, Maggie Knepp, which is Patty Need's mother, continues to fail a little bit, is declining in health there, so keep her in the prayers there. Bruce mentioned this morning, if you notice, there were several people missing, usually on spring break. Caston's on spring break, and I think Rochester is too. I guess I'm kind of jealous of them going on spring break, but we'll keep them in our prayers, so, you know, safe travels back. So, you notice the Passions aren't here, you know. Guy gets all the, So, was there any others to add to the prayer list or an announcements from the floor?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's been a bad week in NCAA, so we won't go there, you know, poor Purdue, yeah. So if not, we'll have the ushers come forward. Butler's own pull through, Butler didn't pull through, Purdue didn't pull through, so, you know, why watch, you know? Notre Dame girls, I don't know how they did, but, yeah, so let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, Lord. Thank you for your many blessings and all that you've given us, Lord. We do come here today with open hearts to hear your word, Lord, and that we may apply your message to our lives, Lord. We ask that you be with those on our prayer list, that you tend to their needs, especially thinking of Emily Ann and Maggie Knepp and John Cunningham, as well as the families on spring break, Lord, that you especially be with each one of them, Lord. We ask that you be with the gift and as a giver as we bring up our tithes and offerings. Ask these things in your name. Amen.
I love that song, the part in there where it says, "You have no rival, you have no equal, you will reign forever." If you would stand with us, hallelujah, what a Savior. We'll do all five verses. Sarah Zimmerman is going to come and share special music this morning.
My soul, remember.
If you'd stand with us again, lead me to the cross. And the next song, How Great Thou Art, in verse 3 it says, and when I think about, or when I think that God, his son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross, my burden, not his, but my burden, gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. We'll do all four verses.
And we thank all of our workers, and we thank you for bringing your kids. Well, I know there are at least 25 people, perhaps more than that, who, when they hear that song, their mind goes back to the same scene where my mind went, and I'm sure for my daughters and for for my wife. We were there at the Grand Canyon, and we were just by ourselves down away from the main part, but sitting on a rock overlooking the majestic view. And they didn't ask me to sing, but the ladies and the girls started singing "How Great Thou Art." But what really made it special was a lady who was looked pretty old back then. She's probably about 62, you know. But she looked really old back then. And we found out that she was Vietnamese, but right when they started singing, she started singing in Vietnamese the same words to that great song. Well, we are looking forward to a great day. Now, we speak of it often because it's so important to us. All of our songs today have referenced the cross because it's such an important understanding. And we've been going through a series, and next week our missionary will be helping us with a message. All of it under this banner of going to Jerusalem. The Lord Jesus came with that one purpose in mind. Now, there was much more he accomplished, of course. But early in his ministry, he started giving hints. People were reading through the Old Testament, and they were bumping into those prophetic statements as we have. You know, when I read in Zechariah, it sounded like Jesus. It sounded like what he was doing. And ultimately, Jesus is now announcing to his disciples, listen, in 3 days, I'm going to tear this kingdom down, or this temple down, and build it up again. Huh? You don't understand. I'm going to Jerusalem. So now it's building. All of the tension, and there's tremendous tension in the land. They are a subject of Rome, and Rome will not put up with any rebellion. And some of the people were legitimately concerned because there was an air of rebellion in the land. But many, at least the leaders of the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and the scribes, and the lawyers, they were jealous. And they were using that obvious tension as an excuse to plan for the death of Jesus Christ. We talked about how Lazarus was raised from the dead. We talked about how Jesus said, hey, listen, it does not matter how religious you are on the outside. It doesn't matter how good people think you are. Don't you remember there was a publican that went into the temple and he beat his breast and he says, Lord, forgive me. I'm a mess. And then there was the Pharisee that came in and said, oh Lord, I thank you that I'm not a sinner like all these other people. And Jesus said, I'm telling you, the humble person left changed. So now we come to another story that Jesus tells. Really, it's just a short time before he goes to Jerusalem. And you'll recognize the story right away. It begins with a situation, and let's take a look at the notes. They're entitled, Compelled to Come, Commanded to Go. We're going to be in Luke chapter 14. I've printed out those verses for you. You'll see them up on the screen as well. And let's start off with getting an understanding of what's happening. And it is Jesus the guest. He comes to this home of a Pharisee. Now, the Pharisee's been a part of all of these conversations. Maybe he was interested. Maybe he was coming. It would appear this way. He was bringing Jesus into the house to try to build up a bigger case against him. But we find here that Jesus gets upset in this man's house. And the very first thing is, he says, he is grieved when we ignore the needy. Jesus is grieved when we ignore the needy. Look what happened. One Sabbath day, Jesus went to eat dinner in the home of a leader of the Pharisees, and the people were watching him closely. There was a man there whose arms and legs were swollen. Jesus asked the Pharisee and experts in religious law, "Is it permitted in the law to heal people on the Sabbath day or not?" When they refused to answer, Jesus touched the sick man and healed him and sent him away. Then he turned to them and said, "Which of you doesn't work on the Sabbath? If your son or your cow falls into the pit, don't you rush to get him out?" Again, they could not answer. So Jesus is again in a very difficult situation. There are spies everywhere around him. The Pharisees are so afraid to say the wrong thing, they won't say anything. And Jesus has been challenged time and time and time again because he's made statements like these: "I've kept every part of the law. I am the embodiment of the law. You cannot challenge me about activities on the Sabbath. I'm the Lord of the Sabbath. Whatever I do because it's the Father's will." And he goes along and he says, "You invited a man," he was probably a plant, "you invited a man who came here, his skin was puffy, he may have had the moisture seeping out, kidneys weren't working, who knows what else might have been the case. I mean, it was obvious that he was sick, and he was planted there right before Jesus, and Jesus says, what should I do? Tell me, what should I do?" He wasn't waiting on their permission. He simply said, "I've listened to you long enough. Let me tell you what. If there's someone who needs help on the Sabbath, I give help." And then he goes on. The people don't know what to say. They didn't know what to say before. They surely did not know what to say afterwards. They're mumbling a bit. And he goes on and he says this little bit. He says, "Now, when Jesus noticed that all who had come to the dinner were trying to sit in the seats of honor near the head of the table, he gave them this advice. When you are invited to a wedding feast, don't sit in the seat of honor. What if someone who is more distinguished than you has also been invited? The host will come and say, give this person your seat. Then you will be embarrassed, and you will have to take whatever seat is left at the foot of the table." Now, all of this is a picture of the culture of that day. When there was a big event, they would put nameplates, so to speak. But they weren't really nameplates at the table settings. It was just understood that when everybody came, the guests would line up the people as to the ones who were most important in his opinion. And these people were all bumping and shoving and trying to get to the front, trying to be noticed by these important people in their community. And Jesus is grieved when we seek honor. I mean, it's really sad, isn't it? Some people are on Facebook, and there's nothing wrong with Facebook, but some people are on Facebook, and they're always promoting themselves. Right now, you can be famous for being famous. I mean, we see that even in the NCAA basketball. There's a particular family, and they're trying to be famous for being famous. And people do that all the time, seeking to be up front. I want everybody to look at me, talk about me, wish they could be like me. And Jesus says, don't do that. You see, we're dealing with really serious heart issues. All of you are seeking to be first. And God opposes the proud. He gives grace to the humble. And then we get to the next part of the story, where we see that Jesus is grieved when we expect to be repaid. It's really important that we do our ministry where the right hand doesn't know what the left hand is doing. You know, when we pray, he said, "Now make sure when you give, that no one knows what the other hand is doing." Speaking of your humility, that you're not serving because people are watching. You're serving because of a need. And here again, these are one of these final lessons being taught by Jesus. And it starts like this in verse 10. "Instead, take the lowest place at the foot of the table. Then when your host sees you, he will say, 'Come, friend, we have a better place for you.' And then you will be honored in front of all the other guests. For those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted." Then he turned to his host. When you put on a luncheon or a banquet, he said, don't invite your friends and brothers, relatives, and rich neighbors, for they will invite you back, and that will be your only reward. Instead, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind. Then at the resurrection of the righteous, God will reward you for inviting those who could not repay you. As a church, we have certain statements and certain beliefs that guide us. And one of the things that we often need to remind ourselves of is this, that we are here to serve all people, not just the people who are like us. We want anybody to be a part of this fellowship, not just those who make us look more important. Now, there's a real important principle that the Lord has been emphasizing time and time again, and it is that principle that God will reward the humble. He'll lift up the humble. He will resist or put down the proud. And here Jesus is saying, listen, my church is going to be built on principles that do not work in the real world, but they work in God's kingdom. So there it is, Jesus the guest. We can say this, to live in God's will, we must demonstrate two qualities, humility and generosity. Now, let's look at Jesus the host. It's quite a lengthy chapter. We start now in verse 15. Jesus the host. Hearing this, a man sitting at the table with Jesus exclaimed, what a blessing it will be to attend a banquet in the kingdom of heaven. Again, probably one of those sympathetic people to the Pharisees, those who are resisting and planning the death of the Lord Jesus. He sits there and now he becomes all smug again, is how I would see it. And he says, oh, what a blessing it will be for all of us to be there at that great banquet in the sky, that great resurrection party. And then Jesus tells a story aimed at everybody there. It speaks to us today, and here he said, Jesus replied with this story. A man prepared a great feast and sent out many invitations. Now, it's important to understand that in this culture, they were not operating with a watch on their wrist. All that mattered was where the sun was in the sky and what kind of events. The only thing that really mattered was the Sabbath day. All the other days were essentially the same. You had to do the same amount of work. You had to prepare in the same way. So what they would do if there was going to be a wedding feast or some great celebration, they would send out the invitation to everybody and say, hey, listen, sometime after 2 weeks, between the second and the third week, we plan to have a banquet. Now, see, it depended on what the weather was like and whether or not the food could be prepared according to the kosher practices. So they would say somewhere between that second and that third week, we're going to have a banquet. So plan for it. So these invitations would go out and everybody would send back a word. Hey, I've already got it on my calendar. You tell me when and I'll be there. So now we pick up the rest of the story. Verse 17. When the banquet was ready, he sent his servants to tell the guests, come, the banquet is ready. But they all began making excuses. One said, I've just bought a field and must inspect it. Please excuse me. Another said, I've just bought 5 pair of oxen, and I want to try them out. Please excuse me, another said, I just got married, so I can't come. You see, the problem here was that there was not real commitment. I mean, even though they said, yes, 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 let us know, we'll be there. Jesus is talking about the hearts of the people in Jerusalem. And honestly, they all talked about wanting to have the Messiah. They all talked about wanting to experience the kingdom of God on earth. But they were rejecting the Lord Jesus. They didn't like the way he looked. They didn't like the way he sounded. They didn't like what he taught. They didn't like the way he did his miracles. And now they're all making excuses. Oh, it's true, we've never had a man to do miracles like this. Oh, we've never had a man who could teach like this. We've never had a man who had the testimony of a man like this. But he's not the man we really want. We don't want him. We don't want to follow him. We want somebody that fits our idea of what a king should look like. A king that has power and authority, who's vengeful. And now the people are saying, no, no, we're just not committed to you, Jesus. We're not interested in you. And we understand how important that is. Those of you who are not married but intend to be at some point, if your boyfriend comes to you and he says, I love you more than the average girl, guess what you need to say? No. Well, maybe if he ups it a little bit. Next time he talks to you and he says, listen, I love you more than most girls. What's your answer? No, not interested. Or maybe he comes up and it says, I love you more than any woman on this earth except my mother. Guess what your answer needs to be? No. No, you need to wait until a man comes and he says, and he's sober, all right? Many a woman has believed a man who was not sober, and that was the beginning of the problems. But a man comes and he says, I love you with all my heart. You're more important to me than any woman, any person in this world. Then maybe you should say yes. You see, the problem was these people were not willing to commit to Jesus. They would not say yes to his teaching. They would not acknowledge the source of his miracles. And they've all got an excuse. Now somebody divided them like this, and I thought it was pretty good. The first was an excuse of material possessions. Now, mind you, the invitations probably came for an evening event, but even keeping that out of our picture, nobody would say, I've just bought a field and I must inspect it. I mean, there were a lot of terrible fields in that day. A lot of fields that you couldn't grow anything in. A lot of fields that only had a little bit of dirt on top of a giant rock shelf. So no good person, no smart person would ever say, well, you know, I was looking in the back of a magazine and I saw that in Texas they had 5,000 acres for sale. So I just called the guy up and bought them. Would any of you farmers do that? I hope not. Because the 5,000 acres is nothing but stubble, right? You would never buy a piece of land without looking. So was this excuse legitimate? It was not legitimate. Material possessions. The next one, the excuse of professional advancement. I've just bought 5 pair of oxen and I want to try them out. Again, you might buy your car on eBay, but most people want to see it first. This, in this day, you would never buy somebody, hey, I've got 5 pair of good oxen, I'll sell them to you cheap. Well, yeah, I'll just buy them and I'll come by and look at them later. No, you wouldn't do that. You'd find a couple of 3-legged oxen. You know, I mean, you would never do that. This did not make sense. But maybe this indicates the guy was more impressed with himself and his position that he could afford to buy 5 pair of oxen. What a load they could carry. Maybe, I don't know. The third excuse is probably true, that it speaks of personal relationships. Maybe some of us would say this guy's excuse was legitimate. If his wife said he couldn't come, he couldn't come. And all the women said, oh, only 2. And all 2 of the women said, amen, all right? My wife said, amen. But obviously that was not the case. It was true that if you were a newly married couple, the man didn't have to serve in the military and there were certain freedoms. But their nights and days were not so full they couldn't go to a neighbor's house after they had already said they would be there. Jesus is illustrating here. He said, no, listen. There's a real problem with the hearts of the people. I am on my way to Jerusalem, and I tell you, wonderful things, horrible things will happen there. You don't understand it because your heart isn't right. And here's what he says. The servant returned and told his master what they had said. His master was furious and said, "Go quickly to the streets and alleys of the town and invite the poor, the crippled, the blind, the lame." And after the servant had done this, he reported, "There's still room for more." So his master said, "Go out into the country lanes and behind the hedges and urge anyone you find to come, so that the banquet will be full. For none of those I first invited will even get the smallest taste of my banquet." Here again, there's a picture being drawn by the Lord Jesus speaking of Israel. "My own people have rejected me. My own people have turned their back. This gospel that was designed for them will go into all the world, and I will accept anybody the way they are." Now think about this banquet. This is unlike any banquet you can imagine. Can you imagine, those of you who are dairy farmers, can you imagine someone saying, as soon as you step out after milking, and you hear the person say, "Come just as you are to the banquet"? All of you would say, "Oh no, I can't. I got to shower and change." They say, No. The master says, "Come just as you are." The person who's digging a ditch, who's been sweating now for 3 days because nobody takes a shower very often or a bath very often in this day, and they get the message, "Come just as you are. The master wants you there today." What a beautiful picture of the gospel going out. We do not just go to the people who look like they need a Savior. We don't go to the people who we think are acting like they want a Savior. The gospel is, you go everywhere and you tell everybody, "Come as you are," because at the cross, sins are forgiven. At the cross, new life is given. Here's a principle that I printed out for you that summarizes it very nicely. To carry out the Great Commission, that's what we're about. To carry out the Great Commission, we are to share the gospel with all people, regardless of their economic status, their physical and mental condition, or their ethnic or religious backgrounds. We are commissioned to go into all the world and preach the gospel. Now let me tell you something that you will find hard to believe. Preachers all across the land will be saying the same thing for the next few weeks. Because this is an incredible opportunity for you and for me. When surveys are done, there was one done recently asking people how often have they been to church, and when was the last time they went to church, and many people said, "Oh, I haven't been to church in forever." And then they were followed up, and they were asked this question: if one of your friends invited you to church, would you go? Believe it or not the majority, but a great number, in excess of 20%, said, "If a friend asked me to go to church, I would say yes." Well, think about it. What are we going to do in these next few weeks? Jesus would tell us by way of this story, "Hey, you go out and you invite everybody to come. You invite everybody to the cross, because the ground at the cross, as it's often said, is level. There's no high ground, there's no low ground. We are all in need of salvation." We are to always present a message of hope to all people, that God loves them and they can be saved if they respond to His grace. That is our commission. And now the latter part of this story. And here he speaks of Jesus the Master. In chapter 14, now at verse 25, a large crowd was following Jesus. He turned around and said to them, "If you want to be my disciple, you must, by comparison, hate everyone else. Your father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even your own life. Otherwise, you cannot be my disciple. And if you do not carry your own cross and follow me, you cannot be my disciple. Again, let's go back to that situation where the man is speaking to his girlfriend, his fiance now. She has said yes. What are the chances of that marriage working if he starts acting like this? Listen, honey, we will always have a date together on Friday and Saturday. But since Monday and Tuesday are not taken with any family activities, I might take out some other women on Monday and Tuesday. What's going to happen? Everybody would say, well, you can't do that. By comparison, you have to hate all the other women in the world and love only your wife. And we would understand, oh, that doesn't mean that you hate all the other women, but it does mean no other woman ever has a place of priority in your life. I mean, that belongs to one woman only. Jesus says, hey, if you're going to be my follower, if you're going to be my disciple, then you cannot have me as your master for certain parts of the week and then have a relationship with the world, the flesh, or the devil the other days of the week. No, here it is. I want you to understand. I want all of you. I want all of you. If you want to be my disciple, you love me more than anybody else. Well, the master goes on. He says, but don't begin until you count the cost. For who would begin construction of a building without first calculating the cost to see if there's enough money to finish it? Otherwise, you might complete only the foundation before running out of money, and then everyone would laugh at you. They would say, there's the person who started that building and couldn't afford to finish it. Or what king would go to war against another king without first sitting down with his counselors to discuss whether his army of 10,000 could defeat the 20,000 soldiers marching against him? And if he can't, he will send a delegation to discuss terms of peace while the enemy is still far away. So you cannot become my disciple without giving up everything you own. Salt is good for seasoning. But if it loses its flavor, how can you make it salty again? Flavorless salt is good neither for the soil nor for the manure pile. It is thrown away. Anyone with ears to hear should listen and understand. So he gives these three examples. He says, I want you to think about it. You're being offered an opportunity to walk with me the rest of your days. This is what the Lord Jesus is saying. You've got an opportunity to be a subject in God's kingdom, to live forever in this place called heaven, this new earth. All that's implied. But you need to consider whether or not you're really serious. Let's go back one more time to that poor lady and her sorry choice of men. If she comes up to the wedding day, and she's not sure the guy is really committed to her, how many of you would advise her to stand up in front of the whole crowd and say, I'm sorry, the wedding has been canceled, it's time for you to go home, I'll explain later. Everybody says that's what you ought to do. If they're not really committed, then you better not marry him. Jesus says, hey, I want you to think about this. If you are committed to me, then you are called to be my disciple. Then you follow. When it becomes hard, guess what you do? You cry and you follow. When it becomes impossible, guess what you do? You give up and ask the Lord to empower you, to strengthen you, and then you keep going. That you follow him because he is the master. One final statement that will summarize it for us before we conclude. To be a dedicated believer, we must always make our commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ. Make that commitment a priority over all relationships as well as over our material possessions. Note the word of emphasis being the Lord Jesus Christ. Would you close your eyes and bow your heads? And I have a couple of questions for you in regards to that. Again, I'm not asking you to raise your hand. I'm not asking you to wiggle and squirm and be nervous. This is not talking about religion. It's not talking about whether or not you should come to church more, whether or not you should serve more, whether or not you should give more. We're not talking about any of that. What we're talking about is what is the condition of your heart. If you know the Savior, there's been a time when you confessed your sin and you said, Jesus, I know that only you can take away my sin. Only you can buy my salvation. Only you can save my soul. If you know there's been that time and you have surrendered to the Savior, then I want to encourage you that it is obvious to all the generations who have gone before us that if you understand that He is the Savior, then you must also recognize He is the Lord. And we follow Him as the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus is going to have a number of His disciples, those who were following Him, turn away because His message becomes more and more focused, more and more serious. We live in a broken down world. There is so much misery in our backyard, around where we live. Forget around the world. There is so much misery and heartache that I believe the Lord Jesus is saying, I am looking for people who will be committed to serve. That's what I'm looking for, people who will be disciples. And every day, you and me, we will get up in the morning and we'll struggle with whether or not we'll give that day to the Lord. This day, tomorrow, Tuesday, Wednesday, all the way through the week. There's never a time when you'll get comfortable with Jesus being your master. It will require surrendering every day. But what a blessing it is for those we serve. What a blessing it is for the rewards that accumulate when His people serve the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, I'm asking that you would be pleased to use us. Lord, we don't deserve to be a part of the great work that's being done. We don't deserve to be playing on your team as we see so many ball games now. Lord, we don't have anything to offer except we have responded to the invitation to come. And Lord, now we receive the invitation to go. So Father, I'm asking that each one here would deal with that in their own heart, that they would surrender, Lord, not to a life of perfection, but to a life committed to following after our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, I ask for this as we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So remember, these people were compelled to come and then commanded to go. Thank you. God bless you guys. Oh, also, out there, there's a bowl of apples. They're all good apples, all right? They were used last week and on Wednesday, and they're leftovers. So if you would take an apple, you help to buy part of that apple. Take one bite and then share it with your friend. Let them take a bite out of the part they bought, all right? Thank you. God bless you guys.